electricity, internet, and blockchain. So this is why it is fundamentally important for us to get our foot on it. So in this session, we are going to see what is blockchain, how it works, practical demonstration, everything. So by the end of the session, you will be having a clear idea about what is blockchain.
Yeah.
Okay, cool. Okay, let's get started. So before getting into the blockchain, let's take one problem that blockchain will try to solve, okay? First, let's say you want a car, a pre-owned car, a second-hand car, which you want to buy. So what will you do, basically? Any answers? So you want to buy a second-hand car, what will you do? What? OLX, yeah. So you're going to search for an advertisement. So from the advertisement, then what will you do? So you're going to the OLX and you're finding the car which you want to buy, then what will you do? Yeah, you contact the owner and you set up the meeting and finally you make the deal, okay? So there is one important question. So before you purchase on the deal price, you want certain things to be validated, such as this car has a valid documents or not, which this car has a valid odometer value, the price and everything. So how will you check that? Based on what criteria you will check that? Trust. So you will blindly trust the owner of the car who is selling. Otherwise, what will you do? So you go into the trusted third-party seller, which verifies the car on your behalf, and you have to pay some additional fees to them, so to get the car. Okay. Still, you will be having a doubt: is that a forged document? Whether you buy it from the owner or from the trusted third-party seller, you will be always having a doubt whether the documents are forged, whether the odometers are correct. You can't believe the third party just because you trust them, right? So, in this era, it is easy to tamper the data. It is easy to hack your odometer and everything. So, this not only in this case, there are a lot of cases like land ownership, financial transaction like banking. In land ownership things and all, you have to blindly trust the lawyers, and in financial transactions, you have to trust the banks. So everything, the trust part plays the major role. So what is the way out? What if we have a system that will solve this issue? It makes us impossible, highly impossible to tamper the data with. Such a kind of system will solve all our issues. That is exactly the problem the blockchain tries to solve. Now, Sanjeev here will walk you through what is blockchain and how it works. Thank you.
Thank you, Racha. So we saw that what problem blockchain is trying to solve, right? So majorly we have systems where trust is required to, trust is inbuilt in that. So whenever we want to make a transaction, we have to trust as a user or a owner or a third party. So we needed a system where trust is eliminated and it is added into the system itself. So that's where blockchain comes in. But before getting into that, I want to make clear a few things, that blockchain is not Bitcoin. So mostly we have this misconception that since Bitcoin is so came out very early and it is so popular, and it is sometimes thought as synonym, that is Bitcoin is blockchain and blockchain is Bitcoin. But Bitcoin or blockchain is not only Bitcoin. So what is blockchain then? So blockchain is a technology that underlies Bitcoin. Not only Bitcoin, lot other cryptocurrencies and smart contracts runs on blockchain technology. So then again, what is blockchain, right? So it is simply a mechanism or technology where you digitally record the transactions, and the system provides you a surety that the data is immutable, that is, it cannot be tampered. And it is not also not, ensures that the data is distributed. There is no single party that you want to trust. This concept or technology is blockchain. So it is all about how the data is stored in the system and how it is ensuring the immutability. That is, once the data comes into the system, how the blockchain ensures that the data is not tampered or not changed by any means. So the name comes from the way the data is getting stored. So data is stored in the forms of blocks, and each block will know what is the previous block. So this way it creates a chain. So blocks creating a chain is blockchain. So what is a block then? So a block is a simple structure where you put your data, whatever data, it may be a transaction data or some historically happened data, and to that data, you additionally add an header to that. So the header part will have two magic numbers called previous hash and current hash. I will explain what is hash in a moment. For now, just think it as a magic number and a timestamp when the block is created. So we saw that it has a previous hash, right? The value previous hash is where the link is getting created. So it points to the previous block of the chain. So this way, the chain grows, and whenever a block is added, the chain keeps on growing. So each node knows its previous node through the previous hash stored in that particular block. So, how this is ensuring, so I can store this data in this way, but how this is ensuring the data? Data is unique. And also, what happens to the first block? We are saying that each block will have a previous block, address of the previous block, and what happens to the first block? So there should be a start, right? So the start cannot have a previous thing. So the first block is in the blockchain is called Genesis block. It is a special block, and the previous hash in that block doesn't mean anything. It doesn't point to any previous nodes. So all other nodes as a valid previous hash pointing to the previous node. Only the first node Genesis block will not have any valid previous hash. So now, given all these things, how the data integrity is proven? How we are saying that data is not tampered? That is where the magic numbers hash comes in. So the hash is the core behind the data integrity. So let's see what is a hash function. So a hash function or a cryptographic hash function is a simple function that takes a message. That takes a message and creates a signature or a hash. So this hash function has three different properties that is supporting the blockchain to be untampered. So what are the three properties? So the first property is the hash function, the hash value generated is random but also deterministic. That is, you cannot guess what hash value you get, but you will always get the same hash value given the same input. So if the input is same, the hash value going to generated will be same. That is the first property. The second property is, even if you do a slight change in the message, even a slightest change will cause the hash to change entirely. So here you can see that I have changed the hello world W to small case, and you can see that the hash generated is completely different. So this is the second property of hash function. So whenever you do a small change, the entire hash gets changed. Okay. So the third property is there is no reverse function. There is no reverse function where you can pass in the hash value and get back the original message. So there is no such function identified so far that will give you the original message given the hash value. So these three properties of hash functions is the core concept behind the blockchain. Now let's see how this is applied in blockchain. Okay. And to have a better visualization, you can compare the hash to a fingerprint to humans. So every human has a unique fingerprint. Okay. So you cannot, if I give you a fingerprint, you cannot say whose fingerprint is it. The only way to check that is by taking the fingerprint again and comparing the fingerprint. So it is the hash function is a digital fingerprint for the data. So so now we can see how the hash function is applied into blockchain. So we saw that previously we calculated hash for hello world, right? So in blockchain, hash is calculated for block data, whatever data you're going to store in the block, previous hash, the timestamp of the block created, and a special number called nonce. I will again come back to what is the special number, but assume that the hash is created using the block data, previous hash, and the timestamp of the block. So what happens? So we saw that if I change slightly the input of the hash function, it will totally change the hash. So if I change the data, or tamper any of the details in the block, what happens? The hash is going to be different. So when I take this current block and create computer hash again, I will get a totally different hash than the 456. Currently, the block says it is 456. But now I this 456 is computed with the previous data. Now I have tampered the data. So if I calculate that again, I'm going to get a different hash. Okay. So you may say that, an hacker is came into my blockchain, opened a block, and edited the data. How long it is going to take him to edit the hash also? It is possible, right? You can just go and change the hash, and when you compare the hash with the new data, it is going to match. So yeah, the hacker can exactly do that. But what is the problem here? So now I have updated the data, I have updated the hash according to the data, but what happens is the next block has previous hash value. It is now not pointing to the second block. So what happens? The chain gets broken. Okay, so there is no more chain, and this blockchain again becomes invalid. Okay, so we now have hash function, current hash function, and previous hash function. So if I change, it will break the chain. What if I go and change the previous hash of the next block also? I can go and do that, right? So I can go and do change the previous hash of the next block, and now what happens? The link gets created again. So now the previous hash is pointing to the second block. So the chain is again, the hacker is so smart that he went to the next block and changed the previous hash. But what happens during the calculation, hash function calculation, we have also used the hash. So what happens now? The current hash changes. So if the current hash changes, the link to the next block will get broken. So similarly, to change successfully tamper a data in one particular block, the hacker has to go to every block in the blockchain and modify the data. So it is going to take a long time. Okay, I have a supercomputer that compute so much hashes in a minute. So I can go and tamper every data, right? So that is still possible. I can invest time and tamper every data in the blockchain. So to overcome this, blockchain has a concept called proof of work. That is where this nonce comes in. So what is proof of work? So adding a block is so easy in a blockchain, everybody can go and update the blockchain and keep adding, modifying the blockchains and successfully add it to the blockchain. So to avoid that, they have introduced a complexity in adding blocks to the blockchain. That is, when you want to add a block into the blockchain, you want to create a proof of work. So what is the proof of work? So it is just the same hash, but you have to create the hash in a particular format. Not any hash, but in a particular format. For example, say the hash starting with 60 zeros. So whatever hash I'm generating for a block should start with 60 zeros. So that's where the nonce comes in. So with the block data, previous hash, timestamp, we have to add a special random number or a string that gives us a hash that starts with this particular format, that is 60 digits of zeros. So this is random guesses. So I have to do 1 in 1 billion calculations to achieve this kind of template or format. So this is where the complexity comes in. So blockchains like Bitcoin has a complexity level of 10 minutes. That is, to add a block into a blockchain in Bitcoin network, it takes 10 minutes. And the complexity is dynamically calculated based on the number of nodes getting added into the chain. The complexity is dynamically added into the, dynamically changed, and every hash generated is based on that complexity. So now we have seen all these things, right? So now even if I was able to tamper the data, it will take time to add the block into the blockchain. And so to entirely change a very big blockchain, it is going to take years for me, okay? All these things is fine, but who's going to do all these things? I just wanted to do transactions, I don't want to do all these calculations. Who is then going to do all these things? So that's where persons called miners comes in. So a miner is a person who creates a block, okay? So he does this proof of work, calculating the special hash and adding the block into the blockchain. Why does anyone want to do that? Why does someone want to work for you? So that's where the block reward comes in. So everybody who creates a block and successfully added it into the network will get a reward. Reward differs based on the blockchain they're working on. Okay? Sorry? Yeah, so the nonce part is, if I create an hash value with my data, with my timestamp and the previous hash, I will not get the hash in a particular format. So to make this hash in a particular format, I can change the data. So I have to add something additional to the block so that it changes the hash value, and at a point, I will reach a hash value that is in a particular format, like 60 digits of zero, 30 digits of zero. Like that, we arrive at a special hash value without changing any data of the block. So without to achieve that, we are adding a special thing called nonce. The data nonce by itself doesn't have any meaning, but to increase the complexity, we need that nonce. Okay? Yeah. So the miner will do the proof of work. He will listen for all the transactions, and once the transaction reaches a particular number of transactions or a particular duration, they tries to create a block. How will they create a block? They have to put all the data, generate a hash. That hash should be matching certain format. So that computation work miner does. And once he successfully finds that special number that gives a hash in the particular format, he put that nonce in the place and creates a block and adds it to the network. So anybody in the network can take the data and verify the hash. So creating a verifying hash is simple. Just put the data into the hash function, you will get a hash. It doesn't take long time. But to arrive at the nonce and the special hash, it is going to take a lot of time.
Yes.
Yeah, it is an open ledger. Everybody in the network will have access to the data in the network, the data in the block. So that's why the next thing is coming. So if we have a single centered blockchain, that is only one blockchain, and if the miners are going to do this thing, then they can easily tamper. Miners, if they think, they can tamper and modify the data. So to avoid that the blockchain is not stored in a single place. It is distributed and stored in as a multiple copies in across different systems. So everybody joining the peer-to-peer network will have a copy of their own, okay? So that if you want to change, you have to go and change everybody's everybody's blockchain. It again adds to the complexity. Previously itself, we have a high complexity of modifying the data. Now the distributed nature brings in another level of difficulty. So here, I'm not trusting anybody. The trust is in the system or the technology. That we know that the behavior of cryptographic hash and the system, so that we can trust the system. And I don't want to depend on anybody. The trust and the intermediaries are removed by this. Okay, now we have another question, right? So if data is distributed and there are multiple copies, how are you going to prove the data integrity? Which chain is correct? So I may be, my system will maybe out of working in for a long, or for 3 or 4 hours. So that time I would miss all the blocks. Similarly, we cannot depend on the networks itself. So that's where the consensus algorithm comes in. So what is a consensus algorithm? Sorry. So what is the consensus algorithm? So everybody in the network has to agree on a single blockchain, which is everybody should, sorry. So everybody in the network has to agree on a common blockchain. So how they agree, how they all come to an agreement is, they all agree on a chain which has the longest computational work done in the chain. That is, whichever chain is longest, they all agree that that is the valid chain. Because to create a long chain, they have put a lot amount of work, and it is distributed, and adding blocks, adding a tampered blocks to the network is so difficult. That is, whichever blockchain as the longest chain is considered as the valid chain. So let's assume an hacker tries to tamper a blockchain. What he has to do is, he has to first tamper a block and create a fork. Whenever you tamper a block, it will create a fork, and the actual block will be continuing in the actual fork, and the tampered block will be continuing in the tampered block. So if the hacker wants to make his chain valid, what he has to do is, he has to compute the blocks so fast than everybody else in the network and make his chain longer. So you can see here that currently the white is the correct chain. The hacker tries to create a longer chain and everybody agrees to his chain. But it is practically impossible because he has to work faster than everybody else in the network. This can be achieved only if they have more than 50% of the entire resources of the network. Then only they can achieve this kind of tampering. So again, the blockchain is not completely untamperable. It is so difficult to change. So that difficulty or complexity of the blockchain is providing us the ability of preserving data immutable. So yeah. So whatever problem we initially saw, right? So we wanted to trust somebody, and it is in the current day systems, it is so easy to tamper the data that is stored in any form. Anybody can go and tamper the data. So blockchain somehow provides that feasibility of having data untampered and also in a distributed fashion. So based on this, we have created a small demo application. So we took a real-time problem that Bosch is trying to solve. So we previously saw an example Raja gave, right? So if you want to buy an old car, you go and check so many values, and one such value is an odometer value. So you want to know how much kilometer the vehicle has run. So that is the one major factor that helps you decide, right? So, but it is easy to tamper data in the vehicle, and either you want to trust, or there are several high costing methods to find whether that odometer is tampered or not. But through blockchain, we kind of try to solve that, create a demo for that same application. Raja will take us through the demo of that application.
Okay, let's see the demo. So here, we basically built two applications. So to simulate the problem, we built this application. Say like whenever you stop the car, so we basically created two applications. One is to simulate that buying the second-hand car. Okay. So whenever we make a stop, sorry. Excuse me. I forgot I'm in a second screen. So say like if you are running a car and whenever it makes a stop, the data will be transferred to the blockchain network. So there is second application. So this is our blockchain application. We built the simple application to visualize what happens in the blockchain. Okay, so this application is only in the perspective of a single miner. It won't show the network or the distributed ledger. Okay, just imagine to visualize yourself. Okay, we have a block. We have a Genesis block. So Genesis block will always have a previous hash as zero because it won't have. Stamp when the block is created and the number of records it's stored in it and the nonce value. So I'll explain the nonce value in a moment. So here in this application we have a three sections. One is this section will display what is the blockchain, what are the blocks it contains. So whenever we click on this session, this will explain the information, the block headers, which Sanjeev explained. And if the block contains any records, this will display the details. So if you go to our second application, so here we have a different amount of cars. We have a VIN number associated with it. Since we are from Coimbatore, we use the same notation. And if you look below, there is an odometer running. Can you see that? Okay, cool. So whenever I make a stop, this information, as I said, it will be transferred to the blockchain. Let's see how it is. Okay, so whenever the data is transferred to the blockchain, it will be in the mempool. They said it's a transaction queue from where the block the miners will take the transaction which they want to resolve and they propose a block. So if you go to the pending records, so it will have the stop records of the core. Here you can see the details, the odometer, such as odometer value. I'll just zoom in. Can you see that? Okay, cool. And VIN number of the car associated with it, and the timestamp and the ID of the particular transaction. So here we have a start mining. So in a practical case, the mining will be happening automatically. So here to demonstrate, we built it manually. So if I click on the mining, so it will take some time to mine it. So we just demonstrated it. What happens in the background is there is a cryptographic challenge that miner has to solve. As Sanjeev explained, there is some say like if you have a hash, they want to create a hash with 17 to 30 leading zeros. So it is producing a hash is completely random. So anybody can get any hash value. So here miner has to spend a lot of computation power to get the required hash value. So whenever the hash value, the process gets easier, the blockchain principle says at every 10 minutes you can create one block. So that's why it's set as like that. Okay, I'll explain it in a moment. So we have created mined the block. So if you go back and we can see the block added to the chain. So if you click on that block, here we can see the block headers, the hash of the previous value. If you see this hash, this is starting from 60E2. If you go to the previous block, the hash value is linked with it. So here you can see the records associated with a particular block. Okay, so let's make more examples and okay, I'll make few more entries.
So this we can assume that these are real vehicles that are. So what is the actual solution of Bosch is to have an IoT device in each vehicle that will transmit the odometer reading into a blockchain network. So this application, you can assume that these are real vehicles attached with that IoT device. So running the car is like driving the car. So whenever you stop driving the car, the odometer value is transmitted to the blockchain network.
So we'll create one more block. So now we have three blocks. Okay, if you want to check the latest odometer value of the particular car, we have a function called find car. So if you use that, we have to enter the VIN number of the particular car which we are interested in. So let's take this bus which has a VIN car of TN40A9999.
So you can see the odometer value in the bus that is in that application. That is, you go see the real odometer value of the bus.
Yeah.
And here it is in the blockchain. If you want to go check the verify that odometer value is correct in the bus and blockchain, you can do that.
So here the odometer value is set in 4122. So if you go and check the odometer value, we are getting the value here. Okay, this is the positive case. What happens when there is a tampering? What happens as a car user, you deliberately hacked your system to deliver the false data? Let's take a look at that. Okay, so say like we have this data and I tamper the data.
So here, instead of, you can assume that I am going and tampering the odometer in the bus. So we have the data for the application is stored in the local storage of the browser. So Raja is showing you, he's tampering the odometer and changing it to some old value so that you can sell it that this ran only few kilometers.
Okay, I just tamper the data and if I reload it, what happened? Okay. Now it is set from 4132 to 3000. So this record was sent to the blockchain. Let's see what happens there.
Now if I just go to the bus and believe the data in the bus, it is going to be tampered. That is, it is not a real value.
It's just a 3000. Here if you check again.
Raja, you have to mine.
What?
Mine again.
Yeah, I forgot that. Yes. Okay, I'm making another stop and now this data is transferred to the blockchain. And if you check it, so we have this data. Now the current odometer is set to 3098. So if I start mining, for our example, we just allowed the tampered data to enter into the blockchain. Let's see how it goes. Yeah, it's here. So here you can see the data which is added. I'll just zoom in. Can you see that?
Cool. So we are just recording the data asset from the vehicle. So we are not ignoring the invalid data. Why? Because now if I have a odometer reading of 5000, which is a valid one, I record it. And if I if the user tamper is back to 4000, and if I ignore that, there will be another entry from user which is 5500. I will accept, but there is a loss of 1500 kilometers. That will go unnoticed. So the blockchain records all the data that is coming from the vehicle, and it does the logic inside it and identifies whether the tampering has happened or not.
Okay, now let's check the latest odometer value. So here we are getting the odometer value as 4122, which is the valid value before the tampering happened. We also gave the notation to verify when the tampering happened. We just took the timestamp of the transaction of the tampered data and we shown it here.
Yeah.
So that whoever buys it can verify it.
You can go to the bus.
Yeah.
So if you just go to the bus, it will be showing the tampered data, right? So it is showing some value in 3000. But if you come and verify it in blockchain, it shows at what point you had the valid data and from where it got tampered. So at least you know that there is some tampering happened and the data you are seeing in the vehicle is not correct.
Okay, there is one more thing to it.
Uh, That's what Raja showed, right? So previously, the first transaction was 4,122. Then he went to the bus, tampered it, made it 3,000 something. Sorry? Yeah, so that is where the security of IoT devices coming. So the loss in few kilometers won't be recorded into the blockchain, but that security is built in the IoT device. So you cannot make that change. So here, this the application we built is assuming that the IoT device will work properly, and that will give only the data that is which is the latest thing.
Since it's our simple example, we just pushed our data into the blockchain whenever the stop happens. For your case, we can just push the real data into the blockchain. In that case, the blockchain will grow a larger, okay? Yes, yes.
Yeah.
So it takes all the blocks in the chain from the start to the beginning. It just loops over the block and just find the transaction, the valid transaction.
Yeah. So for our simple application, we didn't try to optimize how the search is happening, but normally it takes.
So, yeah.
Yeah. So a block is created with. Let's. I think Bitcoin has 1,500 or 1,700 as a limit. So every block will have 1,700 transactions. You cannot create a block for every transaction.
So consider an example like a Bitcoin. They will choose what are the transactions they want to put it into the block based on a transaction piece associated with it. So basically, as Sanjeev said, the block will contain more than one transaction. So the value is dependent on the technology which provides the blockchain.
Yeah, so the reason for that is the time delay, right? So if you create a block for every transaction, it is going to take 10 minutes, more than 10 minutes. And a lot of transactions will be in pending state for a long time. So to avoid that, they are doing. Yeah, so the algorithm we chose is, we just started from the first block to call the transactions and validated it. Sorry? Yeah, so I will show you, walk you through the code. We have just showed it in an array. So it is just next.
Just for a simple example, we used like that. An actual case like Bitcoin, they will use go from the last to previous. So if you use the Bitcoin, you will be having a wallet, right? So in real, it won't be a wallet. So it will validate all the transaction for your account, and it will put together a sum, and it will show you in the wallet. It's not like you are having some purse where you have a Bitcoins, and you just transfer them, your coins will get reduced. It won't be like that. So it will accumulate all other transactions which are present in the ledger, the blockchain. So it will show the data by looping through all the blocks of the chain. Yes.
Sorry? Yeah. Yes. Yeah. So I have to go through all the blocks to identify. I don't know. I'm not creating a block for a vehicle or a block for a transaction, right? I'm just creating accumulating all the transactions into a block. So I have to check all the blocks to know whether the transactions happened for that particular vehicle.
So I get your concern whether we have to check all the blocks or not. So in real life, what happens is that the mining process is proof of work, right? It requires a lot of computation power, which means it requires a lot of electricity. So initially, they used the computer systems and moved from that to graphics card. So now they have a specific device for the Bitcoin purpose. So it will have a lot of hash rate, so which means it requires a lot of electricity. Let's take an example, like a Bitcoin network, all the miners, the electricity they use, no? That electricity can power the entire New Zealand country or Hungary. So that much electric power is used for the mining process. So compared to that, this is just a simple process. But also you have to validate the data, right? So otherwise, if you propose a block to it, so if you just mine the block and transmit it to the network, other nodes will reject it because it's an invalid node. That can be any case. Like, you want to explain?
Yeah, so the basic data structure is that a block should have the data, it should have an header. The header should have previous hash, current hash, and a timestamp, and a nonce value. So the data format is led to the application. So when you develop your blockchain application, you can choose whatever data format you want.
So let's look into the nonce value. If you see that there are four blocks, right? So here in our for our sample application, we just made our hash to contain two leading zeros. So our nonce logic is until I get that required hash value, I will loop through 0 to 0, 1, 2 to the end, okay? So let's see, so the block one, it requires just a zero nonce value since I was the one who created and put it. So when the block two created, it searched for around like 1483 times to get the required hash rate. It's just for two leading zeros. In real-time use cases like Bitcoin, they have around 17 to 30 leading zeros. They have to produce that particular hash. It's completely random. You have to fight with every other miner to propose a block. So if you see the third block, it has only 419 nonce value. It just looped from 0 to 491, and at that point, it found that required hash.
Yeah. So that is why the complexity is dynamic. So based on the blocks getting added into the chain, the complexity keeps on changing so that the time is maintained by 10 minutes. In Bitcoin case, protocol ensures that the complexity is chosen that the such that the block time creation for a block is 10 minutes, at least 10 minutes.
So here, yes, you have any questions? Okay. So here we have one more problem, like the blockchain was first introduced to contain become a decentralized one, right? So every other miner is competing with every other one. So what problem happens is, right, there is a possibility of what is called 51% attack. If you see the series like Silicon Valley, they would demonstrate that with a decentralized internet, which is called PiperNet. Just Google it. And what is the 51% attack? So instead of I am the one who is mining, trying to propose a block, I'll collect all my friends and I'll collectively use all the combined data, combined power, computation power to generate a single block. I'll just share my reward. So what happens is that, say like some person actively get more than half of the part of the network. So what happens? They control the data. Even if they introduce the false data based on the longest chain rule, that blockchain will be accepted. So that fraud can happen. But in real case, what happens? So to produce a single block, you require a lot of computation power. To make that kind of attempt, you had to lose a lot of electricity, which means you had to invest a lot more. It is not like it is unhackable, it is very impossible. You had to, in practical cases, it's very impossible.
Yeah, so in this case, let's assume I want to tamper my car's data. So I want to make the blockchain resemble my data. So I'm going to spend more than what I'm going to get. So whatever money I'm going to get by selling the fraud, by selling the car, it will take a lot more money to tamper the blockchain. So no one will go and do such a thing, right? So that's where the balance comes.
There is one other concern. So when every miner is competing with one another, so what happens is that there are a lot of electricity which requires. Basically, blockchain solves one issue, which is like to convert a centralized thing to the decentralized one. But we also waste a lot of energy to do that. We also have the 51% attack. So to mitigate that, Ethereum-like blockchains have some other algorithm. Say like instead of proof of work, they have proof of stake, where you have to deposit some amount of bitcoins to your network. Say like it's like a security deposit. You'll be having a 500 bitcoins or something. So instead of every other miner compete with one another, the network will select one or two validators. So they'll be the one who propose a block. So that way, the electricity problem is also reduced. It's completely random. You can't double to make a 51% attack. It's still in progress. They are making a lot of validation rules to make it happen.
Yeah. So this blockchain technology is emerging one, right? So there are a lot of areas where it needs improvement. So one such area is that the proof of work concept wastes a lot of energy. So they are kind of proposing other ways to achieve the same result, but with a consuming less amount of energy. That is one such technique is proof of stack.
Let's hold on.
Now Sanjeev will walk you through the code.
Yeah, so so this is a simple implementation of blockchain. So we have our blockchain, which is going to have a chain. So chain is nothing, but we just created an array. So every blockchain, you have to start with the genesis block. Whenever you create a blockchain, you have to create the first genesis block. So yeah. So it's going to be hard for me. It's operate, I will talk. Yeah, so we can.
So first we started the car and stopped it, right? So the transaction is added to the network. We'll see that. So this is the function it calls. So basically what it does is we created it with Node.js and React.js, and it do some validation like whether the odometer contains a positive value instead of a negative value. It's just a simple demonstration, and it adds the transaction to the pending transaction. So whatever there in the pending transaction will be viewed in the pending records in the UI screen, okay? So whenever you start mining the block, so what happens is this. So whenever there is some transaction in the pending transactions, it will mine, otherwise it will say no transactions found. So basically it will create a block. So let's see what block has. So block has previous hash, timestamp, transaction, and nouns set to zero, and has. So whenever the mind block is called, we set the difficulty.
Yeah, so if we set a real difficulty, it is going to take 10, 20 minutes, and to avoid that, we have just set a difficulty as two. So the hash generated should have two leading zeros. Yeah.
So we tried to have a hash value with four leading zeros, our system crashed. So here we are passing the difficulty as two. It will check whether the hash has leading two leading zeros. So when it until it has, it will just update the nonce value. It's like a counter. So
this is the guessing part. So to create the block, you have to change the nonce value until you reach a specific hash. You have to keep trying, and once you reach, then you will be able to create the block.
So now it comes to the calculate hash function. So when Sanjeev presented, he showed like whatever the data you have, even if you make a simple modification, it will produce a completely different hash. So here we have a previous hash, timestamp, and the transactions contained in the block. So that we can produce the hash. So what it gives us is that the hash function also takes care of the previous hash, so that even if you modify the single block, whatever the blocks following it will get corrupted. So even if you have to, you can simultaneously take every other block and you modify it, you have to make more than 51% of network, which is impossible at this point of time.
Yeah, so you can see this, right? So the data structure is very simple. You have to create a block with all these attributes and a simple algorithm to mine and add it to the block. But the real complexity of blockchain comes when you wanted to distribute and have mining capabilities. Implementing a blockchain for a simple solution is really easy. It's not only like you want to implement cryptocurrencies or any other complex systems. We can take it a simple example like this, and you can think of a blockchain solution. So the simple rule is wherever there is a possibility of fraud or wherever there is a intermediary is there, or wherever there is a trust issue, you can think of that as a possible area where you can think of a solution with the blockchain. So we just have a recap on what we saw.
I'll just close this, okay?
really difficult to see it in screen.
I think you have to drag this to the next window.
Yeah. No, I can do that.
Yeah. Next. Yeah. So simply, so we have the hash, which is the core of blockchain. So what is an hash? Hash is a digital signature for a data. So whenever you do a small change to the data, the hash is going to be completely different. And we have a link between the blocks. How we have the link? So each block stores a header. In the header section, stores the previous hash value. That creates a link. And we have to make the addition of block really complex, we have a concept called proof of work, or currently proof of stake. What is proof of work? Creating a hash in a particular format. It is not just creating a hash for a block, it is creating a hash in a particular format, and it is based on the complexity, runtime complexity. The complexity is computed based on how the blocks are getting added into the network. And the distributed nature of the blockchain. So there is no single source of system or single source system which controls the blockchain. It is distributed, and the all the peers in the network is collectively owning the blockchain. It is no one single person is responsible for the blockchain. And the consensus algorithm. So the consensus algorithm is the way how the distributed network comes on a common agreement of what is the valid blockchain. It is the chain which has longest computational value, highest computational value, or whichever is the longest chain. And so to completely tamper a blockchain, you want to do a 51% attack, which is you have to kind of have a 51% of resource of the entire network, and really create a blocks very fast and create your chain very longer, so everybody in the network accepts your chain as a longest chain. So yeah, that's all we had for today. If you have any questions, I can discuss for some 5 minutes. So so our algorithm, how tampering is checked is, we just take all the transactions, tries to see for a particular car, is there a so it is in a chronological order, right? So the nature of odometer value should be increasing in the chronological order. It can now no single point of time it can be lesser than the previous value. So we just go through the chain from the start and check for the particular car's data and see if there is any change. That is there the data should be in ascending order. If it changes at one point where the value is lesser than lesser than the previous value, then we take that as a tampering point. So there we, yeah. So it is based on how where you are applying, right? So in transactions it won't work. So transactions it is not always in increasing order. Sometimes it increases, sometimes it decreases. So the validity of transaction is in Bitcoins is validated in a different format. That is, they use digital signatures to validate whether the data, the transaction is valid and the sender is accepting the data. So the based on the implementation or where you are implementing the blockchain, the validation of validity of a block is differs. So. No, because the validity logic changes, right? So if I'm changing, if I'm using same blockchain for odometer and transaction, then the validation logic is completely different for both. Yeah, theoretically you can do that. So as you said, you can just have the validation logic separate, and but the validation logic is part of the blockchain. So here we are validating after the chain is added, right? Our case, but in transaction case, the validation happens when the validation is when the block is created. So the validation is part of the blockchain, so we cannot separate it. So if the validation logic changes for two different things, we cannot use the same blockchain. Yeah, so it differs based on different applications, right? So we can take the Bitcoin example, right? So Bitcoin, in Bitcoin, if a miner adds a block into Bitcoin blockchain, he will get a n number of Bitcoins. 6.5 Bitcoins he will get as per today. Mm-hmm. So it was it started from 50 and it gets into off every year. And currently they get for a block 6.5 Bitcoins per block. And also there is the transaction fee. So a person who wants to transact amount can add a transaction fee into that transaction, and whatever the transaction fee is added, it will goes to the miner. And the Bitcoin algorithm is set such that there can be only, if I'm not wrong, 21,000 or 21 lakhs of Bitcoins, where there will not be no more Bitcoins. So this process of generating a Bitcoin, right, it is called minting. So whenever new block is added, new Bitcoin is generated. So that newly generated Bitcoin goes to the miner. So it may differ from the blockchain implementation to implementation. Yeah, so basically every blockchain, right, they will have a block token or a block coin, like Ethereum has Ether. So here we didn't think of anything, but we can also have some kind of coins that goes to the miner.
So basically, currently for every block you propose, you get around 12.5 BTC. In Indian amount, one Bitcoin is equal to 5.5 lakhs. Okay, so to acquire that in China and some other countries, they have around huge farms to produce this kind of blocks. Even with the huge farms, they can able to produce only 4 to 5 blocks a day.
So the hit rate is really low. Though the reward seems very high, the hit rate is very low. You're competing with n number of other persons. So you have to win. Every time it is like a race. Whoever comes first, they are going to get the reward. So yeah, so the in Bitcoin's scenario, as Raja was explaining, it is not, so they kind of invented processing units for Bitcoin, mining Bitcoin. There are systems available only that can do only Bitcoin mining. It cannot solve any other problems. So the GPUs are modified to have higher hash rates. So yeah, it's a kind of very huge, yeah. Yeah, so the
so I'll explain this. Blockchain has a principle that for every 10 minutes you can produce only one block. So when you have a more power, if you can able to produce the block in within a minute, so it will, the difficulty will adjust. If it will go from 17 leading zeros to 100 leading zeros. So currently the Bitcoin like systems uses a SHA-256 which has around 256 characters. So to produce that kind of hash rate, you'll be needing a much bigger system.
So to answer your question, right? So the another one area where the blockchain fails is the ever growing size of the blockchain. So it is ever growing, it will never stop. So if you kind of wanted to split, then all the transaction will get lost, right? So, and also it is distributed. Everybody is going to have a copy of the blockchain. Currently, I think it is around 20 GB. The Bitcoin data is around 20 GB. So it will be like ever growing. There is no kind of end. So yeah, you are saying that the amount I invest is very huge. The miners won't do that. Yeah, that's where transaction fees comes in, right? So the miners are the persons once you decide which transactions get into the block. So the if you want your transaction to get into a block, and also there is a limit for how much Bitcoin is minted. So there is a limit. So after that, there will be no new Bitcoin generated. So all those times, how miners is going to earn us through the transaction fees, just like every other in business, right? So you invest, there is a risk involved. So if you have to kind of plan and invest. So if you believe you will get the returns, you can. That's again, it involves the risk involves in every business. There is always a risk of losing the money, but it is again the risk they are taking for running the business.
So adding up to the reward point. So when I first learned about that reward thing, I was like asking Sanjeev, okay, what's your personal savings? We'll just link our computer notes and we'll just start mining. So the process is very complex. We seen some video like they are having a huge farm of acres of land to produce just four blocks of data. That too, if you are the first one when competing with other miners.
And the value of the blockchain again depends on how much persons are using. So it is if you go and see, you can go to Bitcoin or blockchain.com where you can see the trend of the Bitcoin. So it is very flaky. It goes up and down every few seconds. So sometimes, the first time when I know about Bitcoin, the value of Bitcoin in Indian rupees is 80,000 or 90,000. It is some 2-3 years back. So now it is around 5 lakhs, 6 lakhs. So yeah, the value is going to keep on changing. So it is again the business risk they are going to take. We can close it here. Our QA community has an announcement. So there is going to be a VoteCo event which is going to happen this Saturday. It is an half-day event on topics of Gauge and Tycho. So those who are interested, or if you kind of know some persons who are going to get benefited, please share a word with them. You can go to the meetup page, see the details, more details on the meetup page. Yeah, thank you. So I kind of wanted to mention one source that we kind of used it for the preparation. So there is a YouTube channel called 3Blue1Brown. You can go and search 3Blue1Brown blockchain. There is a very nice video of which is runs for an half an hour, which talks about every topic we talked in a very clear and animated way. You will kind of get more clarity when you see that.
Hello everyone, I'm Prem Nisha, working as a developer in ThoughtWorks. Just a quick announcement, we're planning to have a one-day Geeknight sort of a thing, which is about, we're going to cover Docker and Kubernetes, so we wanted to just give a heads up on this. So it's on 14th December, it's going to be here in the same office, and these are some of the topics that we'll be covering. Introduction to Docker, some Kubernetes hands-on experience, and we'll try to cover on continuous delivery with Jenkins on Kubernetes engine. So these are the high-level topics, and it's on 14th December, it's a Saturday. And if you have some questions about how can I attend and who needs to, is there any prerequisite? These are the most frequently asked questions. So anyone who's doing software development will be able to attend this. We'll be giving you an online framework and a platform for you to practice all of that for that day. And it's a complimentary event. You don't have to pay for it. And you can, if you have any specific questions, you can feel free to ask any one of us here. Anything? Any questions? It's already available on the meetup, Geeknight Coimbatore. Thank you. If you, we are going to start off with basics of Docker and go to Kubernetes. So just understanding how things are getting deployed, a very basic level should be good enough. And it's open for everyone, students, folks who are working already in software development.
Basically with some understanding of development. Okay, so we'll be doing it in the GCP console itself. Like we'll be getting kubeclubs credit and we'll be doing live in GCP console.
Yeah, we can connect offline if you have any specific questions. Thank you.
Hi again. So we have snacks, tea in the cafeteria. Please refresh yourself. We'll connect back at next 10 minutes. Thank you.
So hi everyone. Myself Sashikumar, I'm an application developer at ThoughtWorks. So I was supposed to pair with Ratna, who is a data specialist in ThoughtWorks, and for various reasons he couldn't make it today. So it's just us who is going to have fun to this evening. So in 1831 there was a merchant by name Ramu. He used to travel to places and find things which has high demand in these places and high availability in these places, and he used to buy the products which has high availability and used to sell the products which has high demand in the areas. That is what he has been doing for a sustainable life, t-shirts from Tirupur, handicrafts from Jaipur, and tea from Assam, and spices from Kerala. His business was doing good. He was trying to expand it both geographically and adding more thinking of adding more product to himself. But scaling was very hard for him, since there was too many constraints for him to consider before adding a product or expanding geographically. So what were the constraints was mainly, when he wants to expand it more than a country, there was like price, currency, quality, and the vendors from whom he can buy the product and to whom he can actually, through whom he can sell the products, and then the availability and things like that, and then during the transportation, packaging, and the security. There were these many concerns at the source and as well as in the destinations. So that was not the only problem that he was facing. Other than scalability, getting the insights out of it, what were the real products that were actually adding value to his business, and what are all the products that could add value to his business when if he adds it to himself. So these are all the kind of insights and data we can get by data engineering. So when it comes to not just the business insights, there are two more insights. That one is predictive analysis and then prescriptive analysis. What is predictive analysis is like, if I do this way, what would happen? Whereas prescriptive analysis is, to achieve this, how I can do this as a reverse way. So the data engineering, where it starts from, it's not just extracting the insights, storing the right data in the right format using the right storage methods. That is where actually the data engineering starts with. So tonight we'll be seeing how to select the storage locations or databases, and what are all the database options we can consider for the problems. This is one problem that we'll be thinking through. So we have to build a massive stock trading system which has huge volume of data, and consistency is more important than anything else. So when you see this problem, what are all the databases that comes to your mind? What are all the options? How to choose the options? There are plenty of options, right? When it comes to SQL, when it comes to NoSQL, there are plenty of options. What are all the options that we have to take into consideration when we see a problem like this? So just keep this problem with you. We'll be solving it later. And then we have few more problems as well. Types of data. So when we talk about data, and what are the types of data that we'll be processing to get the insights? So there are majorly three types of data. The first one is structured data, which we traditionally saw, see the relational data, which itself has some relation with the data, which will have key, which is easy to process and easy to map with all other fields. And then the other one is unstructured data, which actually there is no schema there, and there is no hierarchy there, and you can't actually see through it, like media data, PDF documents, and audio, video, and all the media documents. And then there is something called semi-structured data, which actually makes some sense, but not actually directly storable into the relational databases. For example, JSON files, which actually has an hierarchy, has a data type, you know, has the schema, but not directly storable into the relational databases, and then XML. So with little process giving to what, we can actually store them into the relational databases by themselves. They are actually called as semi-structured data. So what are all the types of databases we have? So by characteristic and our behavior, we have two major types of databases. One is OLTP and OLAP. What is OLTP? OLTP is actually, you know, expanded as online transaction processing databases. You know, what do they do and how do they actually, you know, make sense? You know, they are capable of executing large number of short transactions, like our DML operations, CRUD operations, and all. Short transactions at a large volume. They are very fast processing, is done to maintain the query integrity of the data. How the effectiveness of the OLTP databases are measured is, you know, the number of transactions processed per unit time. You know, at a given time, how many transactions are being processed by the database. That is the second type by, you know, behavior, which is OLAP, online analytical processing databases, which actually comparatively gets less number of queries than, you know, queries to process than the OLTP, but there'll be more complex queries to process. How the, you know, effectiveness of OLAP databases are measured as, you know, the response time it took to process the, you know, transaction, the complex transaction. And the example for OLTP databases are traditional MySQL, MSSQL databases. And then for OLAP, there's Apache Kylin, Oracle Express, Cognos, and SAP HINA. So we actually, by the structure, they are again classified into two main categories. One is our SQL databases, which stores the relational data, which is, you know, which are ACID compliance. And then there is another type, which is NoSQL database, which is an alternate to SQL database. Why do we need an alternate to SQL database? Like we saw, you know, the types of data, not all the kind of data actually has a schema. There are, you know, two more types, you know, which doesn't have schema, but what is the ratio that they are mixed in the real world? There is more than 80% of the data in the real world which are really unstructured or semi-structured, not really, you know, a completely structured data with schema. So that is why we consider the NoSQL databases. And the since the NoSQL databases are actually not defined, you know, strict to schema, you know, predefined schemas, and then they are highly scalable as well. And there are four more types in the NoSQL databases as well, like how they store the data and how effectively they work with the storage methods. They are document-driven databases, key-value stores, graph-based database, and columnar family. That's just, you know, since we have a presentation set up here, the slides are there, just leave it. And for my, you know, reference as well. Let's see. And there is key value stores, you know. We know associative arrays, right? And the hashes. So they are very much similar to the associative arrays. That is how they work. They are highly scalable, you know. Extreme fast because of in-memory data structure. What is in-memory data structure? So anyone have any idea? How does the in-memory database or data structure works? So in-memory data structure actually is a configurable one, but during the application render time, it actually loads a part of data into the main memory so that it can actually, you know, process it fast. And this is actually the example of, you know, how a key value data looks like. You could see that, you know, even for a JSON data, we can give it like, you know, what is the title of the data and what is the data actually. we can store it this way. And the example of key value data stores, Redis and CouchDB. And then we have column oriented store. So what is column oriented store? Now how does it differ from the traditional relational databases? How have we seen the data? You know, we have four fields like, you know, name, age, address, department, or something. How do we usually store it? We'll have it, we have the title there, and we'll have it like each rows for the fourth column, four columns, right? That is actually known as row-based storage. And how does the column base is different, and why do we need actually such a storage in the real time? Now, how does the columnar works is, as its name says, it won't store it this way, and all the column data, right, just flip it. Just flip the data, and when it comes to name, all the names are stored sequentially, grouped, and then the next column. So it actually stores the columns there, and how effective is it? Why do we need a, you know, column-based database? So there are analytical processing database, which actually the insertion and updation actually won't happen often, but reading the data happens very often. That these kind of databases are actually very supportive for the read operations. When you want to select column, you know, specific columns, column-based records, it is very helpful and very fast to get the data. And then they actually come with high support for compressions. And one of such database example is Cassandra. And then in the real world, you know, big data world, we have file-based storages as well. For your reference, you know, which is not in the presentation, we have two more file formats as, you know, Parquet and ORC. They're actually file formats for big data. We do store it in there, and they have different compression and encoding methods. And instead of databases, we do use the files as well. And then this graph-based database. Now, I would like to hear some of the examples where this kind of database can be used. There, I'm giving hint. I'm just checking. You guys are, you know, awake. Still no answers. Facebook. In Facebook, where can we find this? Like, network of data. When we have data which doesn't actually rely on the indexes, it has multiple dimensions, and we have to query the data with depth. So everything is, you know, given us same weightage and entity. As you could see there is a person Bob, there is a person Alex, you know, and there is a place, Golden Bridge, and there is an event, check-in. Everything is given the same weightage and considered as entities. So, and then we have, you know, edges, which have names and, you know, mentions as well. Who was the author and what was he doing there? He tagged another person, and, you know, the friends, their connections has been also, you know, referred with edges. So example for this kind of database is Neo4j. If you want to, you know, try and use it somewhere else, Neo4j. And then the document oriented. I thought, you know, I'll have less to cover since most of you would have heard about it. Really? Have you guys heard about it? MongoDB? So MongoDB is one such example for document-oriented stores, you know. As we have mentioned earlier, this is alternative for relational databases. So we'll not be having traditional table-like architecture. So how do we store the data in here? Like we saw, just the tables, you know, table-like data, but we won't read it this way. It is flipped, which is columnar, and then we have associative array like our hashes, like you know, data store, which is key-value store, and then what one more, and then the graph, Visa. So what is this one? How does this store the data? This actually, like we do save the file struct. Similar to what it actually stores as documents. And so how do we group it? There are two ways to group it. You know, one way, you know, by default is grouped as documents, and other way you can, you know, tag them using tags like namespaces, and then you can query them with the tags as well. You would have heard this theorem a lot many times in the, you know, data industry. And since, you know, I'm going to repeat it one more time, since this is very, very, very important for us to solve the problem which we have, you know, saw earlier. So what is this CAP theorem and what is it all about? So this is a theorem that says that it has three main property which represents the, you know, one of the features that we can achieve through databases. It says that only two of these three properties can be achieved with a selection of database. With any selection, you could see that this side we also get, you know, MySQL, and that side we have, you know, what is this consistency, what is this availability, and what is this partition tolerance means. When it comes to availability, when you want to query a data, it always has to return you the response, either the failure or the success. It has to return. That is known as availability. What is the consistency? You know, consider there are, you know, different copies of databases. We'll come to know, you know, when it comes to partition, we'll see, you know, how it actually split it. You have different copies of databases of the same data, it's supposed to be. What will be your expectation querying the database? You know, you should get the same result in both the copies, right? That is the expectation that we'll be having. And that is what the consistency actually refers to. And there is partition tolerance, which says that you could have multiple databases of same copy or partition copy, you know, some way, and that you can make things, you know, make querying process faster and make the availability, you know, like you'll be having much more things to achieve with partition tolerance. So here is an example with which we can, you know, see how this actually works. So let's see, there is a database that you have chosen, which actually, you know, provides you partition tolerant and availability. Consider there are two set of, what is partition tolerance? Actually, it is a set of clusters in the big data world. We call it that way. So you, I hope that you have heard this term before. So we'll have set of clusters, which actually will have multiple nodes, which is actually a machines, database machines, you know. We have this group. So when this one is there, which states that there is a partition happened between these two clusters. And there is a node on the cluster A, which I'm actually inserting the data into. And there is the cluster B, to which I'm querying to. So initially, I have set the data, you know, in all the places, my favorite color is blue. And then there is another update I'm, you know, making to the cluster one, to the node one, stating that now my favorite color has been changed to red. And then I'm again querying it from the second cluster, and I'm getting the color which is not updated, which is blue. So that is how the PNA, which is the, you know, this combinations of databases work. And then the partition tolerant and consistency, when the consistency is there, this is just the same, you know, it just makes sure there is, you know, you would have heard the term consensus in the before since, you know, session as well. Consensus is actually a agreement of, you know, between the members. They agree upon a thing, you know, in the group. So when you query the query it from the second node, it just makes sure it has the latest transaction. It just, you know, emits to other nodes which it has the information, and it waits for it. Is this the latest transaction? Either it has, you know, it gets an S, or else it gets nothing. If it gets nothing, it is not going to return you anything. So where you are not going to get anything from there, which you, you know, where you miss the availability. Whereas, you know, again, if you try connecting the other side, you'll be getting the data, which is correct data. So there, you know, you have the partition tolerance and consistency, whereas the availability is not there. Whereas this connected system, so everything will update the other system. So everything will be eventually consistent. When you try to partition this, again, it has to fit in either the first model or the second model. So this is how CAP theorem works. As you could see here, so what we want to achieve with this actually gives you the options of the database to consider. So there is a simple problem, you know. Yeah, it's very simple. Build an internal application, phone directory, app for your company. The main things to consider is, you know, the scalability is going to be very limited since it is just going to be used inside your office. And the consistency, a little delay is totally fine. And availability is not really a mission critical job, right? You know, among these three, this is, you know, we don't have to consider about this. So we just have to consider about among these two, right? So what are all the options that we can consider for this? So it is going to be no partition tolerance, just availability and consistency. So what are the database we have, you know, in this area? So we have SQL Server, we have MariaDB, we have, you know, MySQL. So we can choose one of these. There is another problem. And I would expect one of you can answer this, you know, so that I think that I have done something today. So you have a Spark job producing user recommendation. Consider that as some data. Build a system which sends the data to the applications. It actually gets the data from the Spark job, and its job is to, you know, vend it to the application. So what kind of storage would actually you prefer to store the data? Now, things to consider, scale. You know, you are going to get a huge amount of data. You have to process it. And consistency, little delay is fine, but downtime is not tolerated at all. Must be served fast. So what do you think this, you know, falls under? A little delay is fine. Okay, AP. So no, we can either consider Couch or Cassandra. So that is option. And then, you know, there was a problem which we saw earlier. Build a massive stock trading system which has huge volume of data, and consistency is more important than anything. So there is no concerns about the availability. So what do we have to look into? The consistency, and then there is a huge volume of data is present, so we can partition it. So which side it falls under? CP. Oh, either Mongo, HBase, or Redis. You can use one of these. So we have seen that there are different kind of data, and then there is different kind of databases. And what is this data source? What is it different from, you know, those things? What is this to consider? Since we have different types of data and databases, there is a connection between. So where do we get this data? And how do we get this data? And what are all the ways, what are all the options we have, you know, to get this data? There is mainly two ways. One is batch, and the other one is real time. And in batch, we have multiple formats, you know, through which we'll be getting it. What is batch actually? Batch is a job where we collect data on a scheduled time basis, or when the data reaches a particular limit. So we'll be loading it, and then we'll be processing it as a batch, and then we'll be serving the purpose. And what is real time? As the name suggests, the real time data will get taken into the processing immediately after the transaction occurs. So that is it. So how does it actually make sense? You know, we'll have different, you know, so everything in data world will be configured through a pipeline. But, you know, both of these kind of data cannot be achieved through the same way. That'll be slight difference, you know. There is a batch mode, which actually, what is the difference, you know, what is the advantage of using batch mode and, you know, live data? Why can't we use, you know, one of these for everything? There are some things which has to be served immediately. Like, you know, if you go to any of the pages in Facebook, like Amazon or something, you'll be able to see that there are these many likes for these pages and these many followers for these pages and things like that. This is one of the examples. Like, you know, even though I couldn't see the n number of users who have liked it, seeing the insights actually immediately will make sense. So these datas, we have to deliver it in real-time mode. And why can't we go, you know, for real-time then? If all the datas can be processed real-time. What is the advantage of going for batch? So that we don't have to do the processing repeatedly. We can do a process for a bunch of data at a one stretch, where we actually lack the real-time update. So I don't want to explain, you know, how a simple data lake works. That is the source system from which we know we'll be extracting the data, either in a batch mode or in a real-time mode, you know, streaming mode. And always we'll be storing the extracted raw data in the data lake. So that we'll, you know, even something goes wrong, we'll have a copy which we'll be able to verify. And then we'll be transforming the data, which again gets stored as transformed data. And then you could see that there are two lines, transform and load, and there is a transformed copy which loads in. And there are two areas, which is one is data lake and one is data warehouse. How the hierarchy works and what is the purposes? Data lake is actually, you know, not a fit for purpose application. Like, you know, it will have everything. It will have relational databases, you know, dumps, and then it will have unstructured data. It will have all the kind of data it needs. And data warehouses actually serves a particular purpose, like analytics. And it actually transforms the data and loads the data into the kind of warehouse it actually wants, what kind of data and what kind of purpose based on that. And there is a real-time data which actually on the go gets transformed and it directly goes to the warehouse. And how do we get it back again, you know? Like we have it in the batch mode, we can have one more stage there, which is actually known as staging, where we can again store both the, you know, batch and real-time transformed data, and then we can move it to the main warehouse. So this is how we add real-time data like simply works. What do we have to do it? You know, what kind of insights that we can get out of these kind of data? You know? That is a simple insight which we got out of your feedbacks from the previous sessions, which I would like to, you know, show you, which is, you know, there is 50% of the crowd who would like to want to be a Geeknight crowd who also wants to be a speaker in Geeknight. And, you know, on an average, we are getting, we have an, you know, satisfaction score out of 5, 4.59. We have satisfaction score. And these are all the topics, the speakers, you know, who are interested to present in. I could see some of your names as well. So do give us feedbacks, which is very valuable for us. We are getting a lot of insights from it. Thank you. Nice crowd. Happy to see this. No questions.
Uh, So the warehouse is the a place where we can go for analytics, right? We can pick the data for analytics in warehouse. Data lake is there. So you said that real-time data can be even go directly for warehouse.
How do we actually have it in the data lake? And what is the purpose of data lake? Is that your question?
That's one question. Another one, when you send the data directly to warehouse, suppose in real time, even in the case of any social network, if in the first moment I just make like myself, another 1,000 guys will say like, another 10 seconds after, we give dislike. How do you moderate that particular situation?
First question, you know, when we are directly sending the data, streaming data to the warehouse, you know, what is the purpose of having a data lake at all? You know, in the streaming world, is there a data lake or we don't have it? So in this case, so we have both the ways, right? So we'll be having another stage called a staging where we stage both the data. I was expecting this question, I was giving hints as well. So we'll be having another stage called staging where from the transformed phase also will go to the staging, and then the stream data which comes transformed on the go will come to the staging, from which it directly goes to the main. So there is a job which directly, whenever the, you know, like trigger, whenever there is a data in staging, like when there is a transactional real-time data, it will move it to the main. So in this case, both batch and both real-time data will get processed as it gets to the staging, and then we'll be having the copy in the data lake as well. So what was your other question?
Yeah. I think I suppose there will be some 1,000 guys will give like, and you said that it will go directly to the warehouse. So once it will go to warehouse, probably it will be in that moment. If I make analytics there, I get a positive response out of it. Probably after some situations, it will be people are very randomly giving the dislike for the same particular event. So what is the situation there? In such a case, how do we react on that particular decision you have taken that earlier minute?
Get it. So in data world, immutability is
with the assumption that warehouse are dealing with the frozen data, the data which is already transacted and has been made as a data cube for just for analytics, for taking decision making.
So data, you know, in big data, everything in the data lake, data warehouse are actually immutable. We won't actually revert any operations, we won't be updating any operation. We'll be having the history of logs of all the transactions happened. You know, when there is something, you know, of this situation happens, there will be another event with states and unlike, and we'll be getting it with which we'll be processing the data. We won't be actually undoing anything. There is no undo in the data. There is no update in the data. We'll be immutability is the key thing. We'll be getting another event for that, with which we'll be processing that. When you always talk about analytics, there's always some approximation, and that approximation is most often enough to answer the question we are looking for. As an example, the mood analysis that you're talking about, right? Is it like, for example, let's say 77% positive versus 77.001% positive? Does it matter for a business decision? Probably not, you know? So that's if you contrast with the transactional side, you need that to be really consistent. You don't want any variation there, you know? Like, for example, if it's a bank balance, I have, let's say, 100,000 rupees in my account. You don't want approximation there, you know. When I say approximation, I'm not talking about like some 10%, 20% variation and all. We're talking about like decimals, right? So that's actually where the OLTP versus the analytics differs. Secondly, when we keep the data, you know, when you think about, imagine like a reality of the world, right? You can always take a snapshot of the current state. If I'm here, let's say there are 70 people, let's say, right?
That's one way. That is like maybe next 10 minutes, if you take another snapshot, maybe like there may be 60 people. So one way to do analytics would be you always take a snapshot of the moment in time or moment of a reality. The other way would be you model the business in terms of the events that happen. When you use the events, we are talking about business events, right? Again, as an example, maybe we can take like a restaurant example, maybe, right? One way to model that would be, yeah, the so many end of the day, so many customers came in. And so much of order we had generated. That's like a snapshot or like latest kind of data we have, right? The other way to look at it would be, same with the banking transaction also, right? We have latest balances this much. The other way would be banking, that's a very common thing. I'm sure anybody works in finance systems know. You know, every transaction is actually a log, right? That banking, they do it. Why do they do that? Because obviously regulations require that they do that, right? But if you model the business in terms of the events, and then you, like he said, you know, every transaction will be modeled as an event. Like a business processes will be modeled as an event. As an example, like let's say employee joins a company, you know, employee joined as an event, employee exited or employee quit as an event, employee's role changed as an event, and so on. Everything can be modeled as a first class event that reflects a business process, business meaningful events that are happening. Which means you can always imagine like having a timeline. If you move the reference point, the reality keeps changing in the timeline. Whereas if you always take the latest data, that is at that point in time, what is the latest data that we are talking about, right? So analytics world, again, depending on the business question we would like to answer, you make go by the latest snapshot. The more modern way, of course, you know, you kind of tend to keep the complete history, because there is always some business question that you might need to answer, which will require that historical context as well, right? So again, going back to your like, dislike, or at this point as a reference, or the mood was this was the mood. Maybe after you move the timeline, maybe the mood had changed, you know, kind of changed. Typically in, you know, in the politics it happens, you know, for example, a few seconds is different thing, but let's say over a year or over 6 months and all, if you see, they talk about, you know, hey, by the way, this party might lead. But just keep moving the reference timeline, you know. You see the reality completely changing, right? That's actually that's the power of analytics. If you have the events that kind of captured, and that's the power you can kind of get it there, right?
Thank you very much.
Looking for more questions.
Is there any standard procedure to analyze the data, sir?
Yes,
or it depends on the application?
Yes, of course, you know. Like, you know, there is a standard way that how we model the data. How we model the data, like, you know, the transaction crossing machines, you know, from the relational databases, how do we query it? Like, I was expecting this kind of questions, like, you know, why is OLAP databases are able to process complex queries in less response time, less processing time? Like, you know, we'll give additional dimensions to data, like we'll be modeling it in a way that we'll be able to get meaningful insights in less time from the large amount of data. So I would suggest you to go through dimensional modeling. There is a concept, and we have different types of dimensional modeling like star schema, snowflakes, OLAP cubes, and these are all, like, you know, giving dimensions to the data, and the data will be stored as like facts and dimensions. There are just two things. One is measures, which is facts, and what builds the facts. They are called as dimensions. That is actually a very big topic as well to, you know, consider. And modeling is the key thing, which has to be considered before building the analysis.
See, the analytics is nothing new. You know, if you, I think if you talk to anybody who has been in the industry for a long time, they'll say, by the way, it's 20 years, maybe, or more than that, maybe, right? Data warehouse as an idea has been really old. OLAP is a really old idea. Business intelligence, again, very old idea, you know. Probably, if you go back in time, about maybe 15, 20 years back, you know, there used to be a BI tool called Crystal Reports as an example, right? And there are also other competing products, which is very popular at the time. So there's an idea, this is all nothing new. Yeah. So only thing is, the type of analytics that people started doing is started evolving, right? Why? Because of A, the type of data we're getting changed. Like, for example, previously we cared only about system of records, which is capturing the transactions as it happens. Now we are talking about structured, unstructured, social networking, IoT sensors, just name it, right? There's a lot of big data. So that's also adding to the thing. And they categorize this into four types, right? So they use the word, it's an industry term, descriptive analytics, which is you already have data to answer the question. You just need to do basic analytics on that. As an example, if you say, by the way, what is your last quarter sales? You don't need to do any machine learning here, You already know, because you already capture. Only thing is, your system of records has to be proper. If you're not even capturing, then we are screwed, of course. But if you're capturing it properly, then descriptive analytics you can very simply do, right? The second one, like you said, predictive analytics. Typically, for again, same thing. Will Reliance stock, what will be Reliance stock price next quarter? It's a prediction. Who will win in election? It's a prediction. Prescriptive analytics is like a next level of, it's almost like a pinnacle of the analytics, right? Which is from the data will kind of tell you, all the analytics and insight will tell you, you should be doing this to achieve this goal, right? So I think that's actually where all the AI, ML, all of that coming in, right? So for both predictive and prescriptive, and it's difficult to get it right also, for example, if you had to say, by the way, what will be India's GDP 5 years down the line? Can anybody give accurate number? It's almost impossible, because there's so many factors, Some of it is about maybe market conditions elsewhere. Suddenly, like Brexit happens, suddenly there's oil price goes up. Suddenly, somebody, the free, like for example, all the free trade agreements happen or not happen. There are multiple factors, it's just so complex to predict, right? That's why I think that space is much, much harder. Descriptive analytics is relatively much easier to do. You just have to do basic engineering correct. There's no science in that, The moment you get into that, the predictive space, prescriptive space and all, then you get into a lot of, machine learning, mathematics, statistics, and all of these things, right? That's why it's relatively, it gets harder.
Before starting our analytics, we have to decide so which thing we are going to get. Based on that, we are going with the dimension decision, or any dimension can provide a result of any decision. Sorry, you got it right.
How do we decide what are all the dimensions that are going to give me the right insights? The dimensions are there. They're just right there. You just have to know how to identify the dimensions. What are all the kind of insights that you are going to get out of it? And when there is address, location, these details, if you want an insight which is related to the location based info, or you're going to filter or drill down anything, any such operations you want to do with this location based info, it naturally goes as a dimension. And then there is a time date dimension, when you have history of data and you want to process it. And this is how it actually differs from the traditional databases. We'll be having the date time completed as a column, and where it is actually a different dimension which gives your data a different view. So this is how we come up with dimensions. So they are naturally there. We just have to identify what are all the dimensions based on our use case and the kind of insights that we are expecting out of it.
Yeah, I have one other question. If I'm supposed to.
So in that conventional relational model, we strongly mitigate that duplications. We have to normalize the data. I believe, if I'm not wrong, in big data ecosystem, we encourage that more of redundancy is there. We need more duplications, if I'm not wrong. Or probably we can accept that data with high redundancy. Is it true, or I'm just want to get a comment?
So why do we have the redundancy in place, actually, at first? We have the property normalization, we have asset complaints, to get all of this, there is some sacrifice that redundancy is, acceptable. And there is this thing, dimension, which actually filters out all the unique properties of the dimension, and we will just have the IDs there. And in this case, just the modeling defines whether you have the high, redundancy or not. That's how I think, you want to add anything, Prakash?
It again goes back to what I said earlier, which is to answer the question that business user is looking for, what is the quality of the data required? That's how the data quality, the definition, I'm not telling the accurate definition, I'm sure they would have phrased it correctly, much better than I'm saying, but essentially the meaning is that you have a business problem to answer or a business question that you want to, you're looking for an answer. What is the minimum quality of the data that you need to answer that question? That's actually what matters. Doesn't mean you have to be 100%, consistent, accurate, and so on, right? And if you apply that definition of the data quality, most of the questions can be answered with that margin of error I was talking about, remember? And most often, for most of the business contexts, that does not matter at all. But is it like intensely anybody is going to focus on redundancy? Of course, no. Of course, I'm sure all of us will understand that, right? So why would redundancy come in? Because it makes it other things easier. Engineering easier. Performance is better. If you want to drill down, like for example, of course, after processing all the data, then you get into all the dimensional modeling, business intelligence side of things, right? Serving layer, what you call. So there, like if you want to, let's take an example, right? Let's say, again, go to the GDP example, maybe, like our population example, maybe. Let's say you have India's population is so much, right? And you drill down, you go to state-wise population is so much. Drill down again further, district population is so much, and so on. Now, if it is RDBMS, of course, you might have, normalized all properly and everything, right? Here, is there a need to normalize that? It depends on the performance. In this case, of course, population count will be very simple metric. It won't be a performance problem and all of that. There will not be any challenges. But at the end of the day, it's about engineering. If it helps engineering, we are talking about a big data, which is normally where the size starts at terabyte is the minimum thing they say, right? It goes to petabytes in some big companies. So for that, if you try and do normalization, then obviously you had to compromise something else, which is, as a business, I'm looking for an answer at this time. You can't give that answer at this time, everyday basis maybe, right? Or in some cases, for example, clickstream and analytics and all they do, right? Basically, I go to, let's say, Amazon or Flipkart. I have my own shopping behavior, or I kind of click through a bunch of these things. They kind of use that data to say, and also maybe past buying behavior and say, by the way, while I'm buying, I'm kind of, if they were to personalize the recommendations based on my likely, shopping interests, some of that might have to be near real time also, potentially, I'm just saying, right? In fact, stock market is extreme example, or I would say the most suitable example of that, right? A lot of these things in stock market and all happens in like a nanosecond, microsecond, millisecond kind of times, right? Any analytics around that area, duplication is not necessarily the most important thing, right? So there are some other engineering concerns that come in. So that's more important. At the end of the day, for example, if the business question requires that you really cannot compromise consistency, then of course you should not compromise, At the end of the day, that's what it matters. And looks like, at least going by industry experts, in most cases, you can answer the questions really well with some compromise on redundancy and other factors. And so it's perfectly all right. Whereas in transactional system, their consistency is absolutely important. You don't want to update one and not update the other and so on, right? So there, it's a different concern there. So that's actually where in the, I think concerns are different.
Thanks, Prakash. Any other questions? Thank you so much. Any other questions? Thank you so much, everyone. And special thanks to people who asked questions and made the session more interactive. Thank you so much. Wishing to hope you all, seeing you more and more in the coming events as well. Thank you.
Thank you all. Thanks for your time. Like I said earlier, the motive of Geeknight is to build an expanded community of software professionals. So please let your friends and colleagues know about this event. And finally, you will get a mail to share your feedback. There will be a link. Just click the link, it will take you to a form. So you will be asked a few questions and a feedback. And also, if you're interested to present, there will be a question. Are you interested to present? Please say yes. And what topic, it will ask what topic you're interested to present. Please let us know in the same. You will be getting the mail right now, is it? Yeah. So just make sure you give us the feedback. It's very valuable for us, like how Sasi said. Thanks again. Thank you all. Hoping to see you next time.